Next up on our program is a topic that's going to be of interest of most of you in this room. Nothing sells green fees and memberships like playing quality. Chris Hartwiger, who's our director of the USGA's course consulting service and also an agronomist in the Southeast region, will highlight how to attract players to your golf course by focusing on what's important to them. Chris?
Well, good morning, friends. It's an honor to be with you this morning. And this is a great challenge, isn't it? Attracting players to your course. And how are we going to do that? Well, we're going to do it. A good strategy is to focus on what is very important to them. And for the next 20 minutes or so, we're going to divide this presentation into two core components. The first is strategic, and the second is practical, maybe things that you could take home and implement at your golf facility. And our strategic component, we're going to start by focusing on this idea that the golf experience needs to be enjoyable, or for lack of a better term, it needs to be fun, doesn't it? How are we going to provide a fun experience for a diversity of players that we would like to attract to our golf facility and want them to come back again? Well, I just built it into a very simple equation. And we could probably build this equation if we wanted. But the two components that I am going to focus on is fast, good pace of play, and friendly. So if we can provide a fast, a good pace of play, plus a friendly experience, we've got a good chance that that's going to equal a very fun day at the golf course. Second, in our practical portion of the presentation, I'll share some ideas with how course owners might be able to implement some ideas, how golf course superintendents might be able to do the same, and then some USGA initiatives that may be helpful to you. Fast or slow, which do you prefer when you play golf? Everybody's gonna say, man, I wanna play a fast round of golf. That's fun to me. Well, unfortunately, we've got this plague that sometimes rears its ugly head of slow golf, long, tedious rounds with lots of waiting. And it's very important to understand pace of play at a very high level. As I've been speaking about pace of play across the Southeast region for the last year or so, I've found that there's some common misconceptions. And I want to bring that out in one question and then focus on the answer to that question. And this is the question for all of us. What are golfers purchasing when they pay a green fee or join a golf course? Are they purchasing a scorecard? Not necessarily. Are they purchasing a pencil? Not necessarily. I mean, those are the only things that they're probably going to take with them tangibly when they leave that day. Well, really, what they're purchasing, and I think it's what I need to be mindful of constantly, and I would recommend that you're mindful of this, is they're purchasing an experience. They're having the chance to go out on a completely unique piece of property, play a really challenging game, and maybe do it with some of their best friends. They're purchasing an experience, and that's why pace of play is so important. If we let things mar or tarnish that experience, we're putting ourselves a step backward in attracting and retaining golfers at our facility. So many of you have seen the TV show Mythbusters. You know, Adam and Jamie, they blow up things, they test a lot of things. They're not here today, but we're going to play Mythbusters Pace of Play edition, and we're going to look at two of them briefly. Number one, I hear this all the time. Oh, Chris, I'm so happy the USGA is doing something about pace of play. I mean, personally, I think it should never take more than 4 hours to play a recreational round of golf. Is that a fact or is that a myth? We're going to check it out. Myth two. Oh, you know what? I had a horrible experience at so-and-so, and I mean, I can't believe my misfortune that I was stuck behind this group, and you're not going to believe the things they were doing, and it was utterly miserable. So our second myth is this assumption that slow play is always the fault of one or more golfers in a group somewhere in front of me. And we'll sort of give ourselves three answers. Is this myth confirmed? Is it plausible? Or is it busted? Now we move to the interaction portion of our presentation. So let's text in some responses to this poll question. The poll question is, it should never take longer than 4 hours to play a recreational round of golf. Text in 31368 if you think that's true. If you think it's false, 31742. I mean, that's the question today. We see some answers coming in. Don't be shy to use that cell phone. It's pretty cool. Well, there we are. We sort of see a pattern. I cannot see the final number on the false, but since the blue bar is going off the screen, I'm going to assume it's a better number. And I also assume that you are paying close attention to Dr. Pringle's presentation, and that is absolutely false. Why is that false? Let's come at it from a different angle. And we come at it from our laboratory, which is the golf course. When we say that it should never take more than 4 hours to play a round of golf, we sneak a couple of assumptions in there, don't we? We assume automatically that 4 hours is fast golf and there's never any waiting. You know, does that mean that when we go to a much shorter, maybe an older course, that with tee and green complexes close to each other, that we can't wait and play in 3 hours and 55 minutes? No, that's happened to me plenty of times. So the other assumption is that all courses are about the same length because they have 18 holes. And we know that's not true, but we kind of sneak that assumption in there when we say that all golf at the recreational level should take 4 hours or less. Good example, my home course in Alabama, from the first tee to the 18th green is 5.7 miles. But if you go into Wisconsin and play at Erin Hills and you walk from the first tee to the 18th green, it's going to be about 8 miles. Which one's going to take longer to play, assuming both courses are the same difficulty? That's not hard. It's the longer golf course. So a four-hour round may be slow or it may be fast. Now this guy and his legion of fans, if he gives you this look, it means he's not having a good experience. He doesn't like to wait. And most golfers, they'll describe a great experience as one where play flows and they do not wait to hit shots. So we're really not talking about the length of the round per se. We're talking about that flow. Remember, we're purchasing an experience. We want it to be a good one. And we all know when we're waiting to hit shots, that's not a good golf experience. So that's what the USGA we're working towards is trying to educate and discover causes of slow play and implement solutions over time to help people be able to flow through a golf course and have a great experience. So we'll say that myth one is busted. Now let's go to myth two. Slow play is always the fault of one or more golfers in a group in front of me. So let's go back out to the lab, that's our golf course, and see what the data says. Well, in our results, certainly we did find or identify a few groups who held up others while looking for balls, not being ready to play, and who took pre-shot routines to an entirely new level. That can always happen. That can happen sometimes. We also found that in the absence of slow golfers, slow play could still exist simply by overloading the course. Matt said it beautifully. If we're letting too many cars onto the freeway at the same time, we can have a traffic jam. plenty of more information. This is another plug for our Pace of Play Resource Center. There's the web address there. I encourage you to check it out. It's got information for golfers. It's got information for golf course owners. And it's got some really neat videos explaining these concepts. So I would say that myth two is plausible. So even in the absence of really slow players, there can still be traffic jams. Well, let's shift gears. That's why pace of play is important. Let's add in the friendly golf. What in the world am I talking about when I mean friendly golf? And I would submit to you that friendly golf is going to vary based on the group who's playing the course. And I would come to you boldly and say that I am uniquely qualified to comment on friendly golf. And here's why. I'd like you to meet my family. I'm there on the left. Statistically, I'm an above average golfer. If we could go one slide back, that would be helpful. Statistically, I'm above average, so I'm like the regular Joe, I guess you could say. My wife, in addition to being a champion golfer, plays with women of many different levels of ability, so she sees the game from the women's perspective, and I know a little bit about that. And unless I'm playing with her, I have no idea that the forward tee that was put right next to the cart path for convenience sake is a terrible angle to play to the fairway and to the green. But it happens all the time, and I hear about it. My daughter Erin, her name is intentionally written in pink. I'd call her more of a social golfer. She can take a triple bogey like nobody's business and be on the next tee with a smile on her face. Because what she wants to do is be outdoors, be with her friends, and she's going to look good when she goes to the golf course. That's friendly golf to her. And to my son, you can see he's not necessarily into traditional golf apparel, but he's a competitor, and he's a beginner. And somehow, when he was a 9-10-year-old kid, somehow he thinks he ought to be able to beat his mom, who's a multiple state champion and a national champion. And I tell him, patience, young man, patience. That's what you need. But he goes out. He's not into turf conditioning. He just wants to go out and try to get better at the game. So I've got a little bit of a unique perspective. And let's broaden that a little bit. Here we have a picture of an Executive Women's Golf Association chapter. What's friendly to this group of golfers? Do you know? Well, they've told you, and they've told you publicly. And here's a summary of what they've said. They conducted a survey, and here's why you should pay attention to these folks. They play an average of 32 rounds a year, and on average, they spent $4,300 on golf each year. They loved being outdoors. They loved being with friends. They liked the challenge. And look at this. They said they want a course that's fun, challenging, but playable for all. So pay attention to this group. If you don't know this group, I encourage you to get to know them. They're willing to spend money, and they want a fun golf course to play with their friends, who obviously are of all abilities. There's some additional NGF data on women in golf that I would call your attention to. In 2005, we had 7.1 million women participating in golf. And unfortunately, in 2011, probably for a variety of reasons, that number is down to $5.4 million. Not doing a good job retaining those golfers. They accounted for about 17% of all the rounds. In 2007, the NGF conducted a profile on women in golf and said that 60% were embarrassed. They didn't know more about golf. The majority were intimidated by other players, staff, or the environment, the culture at the golf facility. Folks, there's tremendous strides that can be made here at every facility to make it more friendly to this group. The data's out there. They're telling you. They're telling you, help me out here. I'm interested in this game, but there's some things that make it unfriendly. And remember, in our equation, fast plus friendly equals fun. And if we aren't doing a good job on the friendly part, our equation isn't going to add up. Some specifics on women in golf: nervous playing with or ahead of men. The holes were too long. Ding, ding, ding. Sirens ought to be going off here. Rounds are too long. Amenities like drinking water, clean bathrooms, and healthy food are scarce. Male staff not attuned to their needs. And I hear this from my wife frequently. Let's shift gears to the male golfer. And I would ask this rhetorical question. Who are your best male customers? Well, perhaps it's those that play most often. We could argue from that point of view. Or we could say your best male customers are the ones that have the most common handicap. And here's an additional part of our interactive poll, or interactive presentation. What do you think is the median USGA handicap index for men? Is it 12? Is it 15? Is it 18? Is it 20? Or is it 22? And I think we have about a million male golfers in our Gin handicap database, so we have a pretty good feel for this one. Let's see, give it a guess. You've got five options here, and let's see what you have to say here. And the results are coming in. We're seeing a trend. Okay, 20 looks like it's the most popular, with 18 creeping up. 15. Isn't it interesting that we haven't even had one contrarian out there that wants to put in 12 as the most as the median USGA handicap index for men? Remember, going back to our eighth grade math, median, that means the same number above and the same number below. There we go. I knew we had a contrarian in the audience. Okay, we've got some good data here, and the median USGA handicap index for men is 15. So they're a little better than our audience thought. I would have guessed you would have picked 12 or 15. Well, there you go. All right. And if we could go back one slide, please. And here you go. Let's focus on just 2 points on this slide. This is coming out of our handicap stats in Far Hills. There we go. The median handicap index for men is approximately 14.5. I rounded it up to make it 15. I want you to see that 87% of your golfers have an index higher than 7. 87% of your players have a handicap index greater than 7. They're not going to be playing in the U.S. Open, folks. They're not. And I'm right on the border of that group. I'm not going to be playing in the U.S. Open anytime soon. So we need to be thinking more about who your best customers are and not preparation for the 13% that are probably either single digits or plus handicaps. All right, let's shift gears. Who are your best female customers? Let's go to another poll question and ask the question, what is the median USGA handicap index for women? Is it 15, 21, 27, or 31? What do you think? Our audience doesn't seem very confident to participate in this one. Here we go. The results are coming in. And I tell you, the trend seems to be 27, although 21 is creeping up, and we have full participation in all the options here. That's good. Okay. Well, it looks like it's nearly a tie between 21 and 27. It is a tie now. Well, let's go to our Gin handicap database and see. The median handicap index for women is approximately 27. And I like to phrase it this way. 89% of the women with a handicap index that play your golf course, on average, are going to have an index greater than 16. There's lots of things that we can draw from that, but I want you to think about who your best female customers are, and are you addressing what a friendly and what a good golf course is for them. All right, so those are your best customers, and I've got a hypothetical couple here, Colonel Bogey and his wife, Mrs. Bogey. How do they actually play golf? We're going to say Colonel Bogey has about a 17 to a 22 handicap, and Mrs. Bogey, she's a little better than average. She's about 21 to 26. And this is USGA data. This isn't off the top of Chris's head. Here's how they play the golf course. The Colonel, who's retired, he hits his drive with carry and roll about 200 yards, and we think that the longest par four that he's able to reach is about 370 yards. So, quick little check, if the 18 handicapper, you look at your scorecard and there's hole after hole of par fours longer than 370 yards, it may be the NFL for him, it may be the no fun league, because it gets a little tedious when you can never reach par fours in regulation. You might be able to make an adjustment. Mrs. Bogey, her average drive carry and roll is about 150 yards, and we think that the longest par four that she's going to be able to reach is about 280 yards. And when I learned these statistics a couple of years ago, and I visit golf courses, I find it very interesting to look at scorecards. I just grab a scorecard and I look, and from the most forward tees, I consistently see hole after hole that are longer than 280 yards. Man, and I tell you, that's working against the fun factor. That's the no fun factor. We've got some work there to adjust for our best and most popular customers. All right, so let's take it down to the golf course level. Let's move to the practical level. How does your course play for your best customers? Is this an optimum tee shot for the 15 handicapper? Probably not. If we want to move people through the golf course and have a pleasant experience at fast pace, it'd be nice to see the landing area. It'd be nice to get the ball off the tee freely. Is this what you'd call friendly rough? Not friendly. I'd say this is a much friendlier option. I like this. This is golfer-friendly rough. How about this? This was a true-to-life story. Standing in this bunker, asking one of the course officials, "Well, I see you've got a bunker here, and I've seen you've planted some trees in front of the bunker, essentially limiting my option to go for the green. Tell me about that. What was the thinking there?" "Well, we just thought this hole was too easy." Okay? So that's the no fun league to me. Two obstacles. Again, the U.S. Open's great. It's held once a year, and there's some great players, and a lot of effort goes into hosting it. But for everyday golf, boy, there's an opportunity to move more to a definitely a fun model. So if we're going to have golf that's fast, and we're going to have golf that's friendly, I really submit to you that it's going to be fun, and people are going to want to come back. They're going to want to spend more time at your facilities. So how might this look at the local level? There have been some really neat case studies where people have sort of stepped out of their comfort zone. A couple that owned a golf course, Province Lake, Arthur and Sally Little, they developed what they called the 65% solution for forward tees. They would just take the most popular tee for men, and they would set the most forward tee at 65%. So what they came up with on average was the par threes were all below 150 yards, par fours were below 280, and the par fives were below 350. The forward tees were just a little bit over 4,000 yards, and they said, "Hey, you know what? If we offer some amenities, like more women in the golf shop, daycare, healthier food, we think we can get some good results." Did it work? Well, I'm glad you asked. Women's rounds tripled. Women accounted for 35% of total rounds. Those are real dollars, folks. Women shot lower scores. Some women will tell you, "I'm not really interested in the score I shoot," but But I still say it's fun to I'd rather shoot a lower score than a higher score, and the length of the round decreased. I'd say that one change, boy, it made it faster, it made it friendlier, and they voted with their wallets and their feet, and they showed up and they played more golf there. Well, currently a very popular golf entrepreneur, Mike Kaiser, he sort of got to know the Littles. They came out to Bandon Dunes, and he thought, you know what? We're not doing anything like that. So he developed new forward tees at Bandon. They called them the Royal Blue Tees, and these are the yardages for their four courses. You know, much shorter than the traditional forward tees, much shorter, under 4,000 for three of the four. He says now 11% of their rounds are from women, and he said if we wouldn't have done this, it would have been back down around 1%. So what a great boost to his business. How much did it cost to install these more forward tees? Virtually nothing. Many of them can be installed in flat or areas in fairways that have been flattened for next to nothing. I mean, there are just opportunities to make golf more more friendly. We've got great initiatives with the PGA of America, Tee It Forward. You're all familiar with that. The PGA of America will even provide you with, at no charge, a manual on how to develop a family course, basically to put the concepts that I've just talked about into practice, how to build forward tees. And now, let's shift gears. How can a golf course superintendent make golf faster and friendlier? And I know I'm mainly speaking to superintendents, and you have a tremendous influence on the golf experience at your course. Through our pace of play research, we sort of categorize five factors that affect pace of play, and I'm going to focus only on one: course maintenance and setup. And here's a little mini laundry list of things that you can do, things that you can think about, strategies that you can devise and implement at your facility. Hey, always double checking. Do my tees and my tee markers line up to the middle of the landing area? What about the landing zone width? Jim Moore's going to show you some great information on this in a minute. Are my most popular golfers, what about the width of the landing zone? Is there a presence absence of high grasses? What about this trade-off between hole locations and green speeds, or the slope of the hole location and the green speed? All of these things can be managed proactively to impact the golfer experience. And finally, how is the USGA helping courses address pace of play? Third time we've mentioned it, and it's intentional, it's strategic, this Pace of Play Resource Center. We really want you to go check it out. Dr. Pringle is ongoing with his research projects. We've heard in detail the plans for 2014. Jim Moore is going to fill you in on his research conservation efforts in the next presentation. In the course consulting service, we now have a playing quality evaluation consultation that includes a pace of play component focusing on the impact of course maintenance on pace of play. So we're on this. We're moving forward, and we're looking forward to helping you in as many ways as possible.